well, those few of us who are here today can learn something about Banach spaces. I wish I could remember that line from Henry V. Jack.
Something about the breach.
Yeah, those lucky few, those at home today will feel accursed they were not here to something something. Anyway, I can't remember. Okay, so in some sort of strictly logical sense, this whole course has been upside down, and we could have and should have done Banach spaces at the beginning before we even mentioned Hilbert spaces, because in some sense they're simpler logically somehow, and more general, and there's no reason we couldn't have done everything in this section of the course right at the beginning. That's from a purely logical point of view. So a Banach space is just a complete norm vector space. Great. But the reason why I don't think it's a good idea to just start with Banach spaces, although some very good books do, is that Banach spaces are sort of getting to be a bit abstract nonsense. And you don't have very many tools available, and so proving things about Banach spaces in general can be a bit of a grim process. And so one wouldn't really have done it if it didn't turn out to be important. And the only way you see that it's important to do this somewhat hard work with these abstract Banach spaces is that there are lots and lots of examples that sort of don't fit in anywhere else. So, the first example, of course, is every Hilbert space. You just forget the inner product and just remember the norm that it induces, and by definition of Hilbert space, that's a Banach space. And we sort of wish that we could have stopped there, but there are plenty of other examples. So if you look at a compact Hausdorff space, or compact metric space, with the supernorm, we know that that forms a complete norm space, and this is very much not a Hilbert space. And then, of course, there's all of the LPs for measure spaces, although that's a theorem that we haven't actually proved yet, and should get around to doing sometime soon, that these guys with their norm, the LP norms, are actually complete. We haven't seen yet. And then the set of signed measures. Maybe it's even better to write x, comma, curly m, although then there's too many m's, on a measurable space. You can look at all the different measures, and if you look at the signed ones, so that you're actually allowed to take complex linear combinations of them, it turns out that those are complete as well. And again, that's something that we haven't done. But another really important example is just B of H. Fix your favorite Hilbert space and look at the collection of all bounded linear operators on it. That, of course, has a norm, the operator norm. I think we proved at some point that was actually complete, the operator norm. And then there's what I have to admit are the real examples, but I will also admit that I actually don't know too much about this world. All the Sobolev spaces and the Hilbert spaces, which are the places study PDEs in, which is definitely not my subject, but a big part of the reason for doing this generality of let's do Banach spaces is that in order to look at the solutions of PDEs, you inevitably find that you're looking in these strange norm spaces where often you wanted to find very, very complicated norms in order to see that the operator corresponding to your differential equation, that is the differential operator, you want to hope that that operator is either bounded or maybe has a bounded adjoint or a bounded inverse or something. But often to do that, you have to design a very clever norm on your space so that your operator or some related operator is actually a bounded operator. And that's the reason why people invent all these strange spaces. Ooh, that's not baseball. So I can see I really don't play with it. And so to study PDEs, we come up with very strange Banach spaces. Those are some of the first ones. Okay, so that's an attempt at justifying the horrors that we're about to encounter. No, it's okay, it's not that bad. So we're going to start by, let's just do some basic stuff about Banach spaces, but hopefully by the end of today, we'll get to do things like perhaps even the uniform boundedness principle if we're fast. So a first thing is that all complete norms. On V are equivalent if and only if V is finite dimensional. So first of all, what does it mean for two norms to be equivalent? So for now, these subscripts 1 and 2 don't mean like an L1 norm and an L2 norm. They're just like two norms that need to be numbered, so we can talk about them. Are equivalent if there's a C, some constant, so that the norm of any vector with respect to one of the norms is bounded above and below by a constant times the norm according to the other norm. Maybe we put a C there and a C inverse there. Okay. Obviously, we could have just put an A and a B here, just said there were two constants, but obviously that's equivalent to just having a single C that makes that. Okay. So, great. So this basically tells us, like, this does have some interesting consequences. I mean, like, for example, you can look at LP spaces on some finite set that's just C to the N with the LP norm. You take the pth powers of your n different numbers and add those up and then take the pth root. They're actually sort of, those things on a finite set, C to the N with the LP norm, are actually all the same Banach space. The P didn't matter. But as soon as we go to infinite things, then the LP norms are actually inequivalent. Okay. So this is not that exciting, but it's a good exercise. We're just going to prove one direction today. So finite dimensional implies all norms are equivalent. And we're going to do this by an act of violence. So we pick some finite basis, and then just define some new norm. Of course, now we can write any vector as a linear combination of our basis, so the new norm can be the bullet norm, since it's defined via violence. Is just going to be the sum of the absolute values of the AIs. Okay? And we'll just show any norm is equivalent to this guy. And it's pretty easy to see that equivalence is an equivalence relation. So that does that. Okay, so how do we do this? Well, let's look at the norm of some arbitrary vector. So this is just the arbitrary norm we're thinking about now. And of course, we can just use triangle inequalities to move the norm inside, and then use homogeneity to pull out absolute value A, so we get some absolute value AI norm VI. And of course, this is a sum over this fixed set of basis vectors here. So the point is that this is then less than the maximum of the absolute values of the AIs, where I'm just going from 1 to n, times, sorry, that's not what I wanted to do, sorry. I want to take the maximum of the other bit. I want to maximize over this bit here. That is just some fixed collection of vectors, so we can pull that out times the sum of the ai's, which is just m, where m is that maximum, times the bullet norm of that guy. Okay? So we obtained a bound one direction, we got the bound up that way. Okay. The other direction is actually pretty easy. So, but let's just say a little bit of language. So thus, x goes to the norm of x is continuous with respect to this other norm. Okay? We've got two different norms here, and we're saying that one is a continuous function when you're using the other norm to describe the topology. That's exactly what this statement from beginning to end says. You take the norm of something, that's this other norm, it's bounded by some constant times the bullet norm. But yeah, we obtained the C there. Okay. Now, the so we can see that the bullet norm is non-zero. This guy, the other norm we're interested in, the other norm we're studying is non-zero on the bullet norm unit sphere. Okay, so if you look at a vector where the bullet norm is 1, then the other norm is non-zero, okay? And why is that? We've just got this condition that says the norm of something is 0 if and only if that vector is 0. So if you're on the bullet norm unit sphere, you're not the 0 vector, and therefore this is not 0 either, okay? Squeeze this in here. Since the bullet norm unit sphere is compact, you might think about exactly how we know it's compact at this point. Let's maybe come back to that point and proceed on. We can immediately say this other norm has a minimum value, S, which is strictly greater than 0. Okay? So we're non-zero everywhere. Euclidean theorem is actually a minimum, so it's non-zero on that sphere. So what did we get from that? That gave us the lower bound. So we just proved. Well, so I guess now what you can say is that because both the bullet norm and the other norm we're studying are homogeneous, what we just proved was that this other norm of x is greater than or equal to s times the bullet norm. Okay, and that if you rearrange things, gave us the opposite bound from this one. That's saying that this other norm is bigger than the bullet norm up to some constant. Okay. So why do we have this? How do we know that this unit sphere is compact? So we're basically, the vector space we're in is just Cn as a vector space. Okay? But what do we need to do to see that some subset of Cn is compact? We just want to check that it's closed and bounded. But we're going to be a little bit careful. There's a few different notions of seeing that it's closed, we just need it to be defined by being cut out by some continuous function. And sure enough, this is continuous, this is a continuous function on Cn, no matter which vi's you picked. Okay, so we're over some closed set, and similarly, after you've picked some of the vi's, you can see that this being equal to 1 is cutting out some bounds here. Okay. So it's just the whatever that theorem is called, kind of irrelevant. Okay. Great. Okay, so we had two norms on a finite dimensional vector space were automatically equivalent. And in fact, as soon as you have an infinite dimensional vector space, you can write down two different norms which are equivalent. But let's leave that for now. What do I want to say? Let's write Vxy is the vector space of bounded linear maps between two Banach spaces. So here, obviously, when you say what bounded is, you're using the two different norms in the source and target. And we can define a norm on this just to be the supremum over all f, whose norm according to the Banach space X is equal to 1 of the norm of T of f, but that's the norm that we're meant to be using over in Y, whatever those norms are. And just as in the Hilbert space case, this norm makes B of X to Y into a Banach space. Okay, so not only is this function here a norm, B of X to Y is actually complete with respect to this norm. Cauchy sequences in B of X to Y converges. If you like category theory, you might say Banach spaces form by a closed category. Look up what those words mean and understand why it was just a unnecessarily fancy way of saying that. Okay. There is a bit of content in here in this claim that norm makes B of X to Y into a Banach space. But it really is exactly the same argument as we used in the Hilbert space case. That's one instance of why maybe we ought to have started with Banach spaces in the first place. Secretly, some of our theorems do generalize very easily. Okay, so the special case here, if Y is just the complex numbers, and I'm not going to specify with the usual norm, but there aren't many alternatives besides the usual norm, just the usual norm after the scale. Let's just have the usual norm. The space of bounded linear maps from X to C is just the bounded linear functionals which we'll always write as X star. Okay. So a priori, we know nothing about X star. So in the Hilbert space case, life was glorious. Our Hilbert space had a basis, and then every bounded linear function, maybe I shouldn't say anything about a basis, but the first version of the Riesz representation theorem just told us that every bounded linear functional in a Hilbert space was given by take the inner product with some fixed vector in the Hilbert space. And indeed, they were all bounded linear functionals. But unfortunately, in the Banach space case, we have sort of no equivalent to that. And in fact, X dual can be both much bigger than X and much smaller than X, or just sort of incomparable. Even to prove X dual is not just the zero vector in general, requires the axiom of choice. And this is what's called the Hahn-Banach theorem, which we'll get to in a day or two. It gives us a big supply of bounded linear functionals on Banach spaces, but it does make us sell our soul in order to get access to them. Okay, so life is a little bit scary there. Just foreshadowing something that we will get to later, we have a natural map. This is sort of 11:15 sort of material. X into X double dual, okay? So given a vector X in here, well, in the double dual, I'm meant to give you linear functionals on linear functionals. So I'm meant to give you some gadget that takes a linear functional and spits out a number. And the obvious way to do that is to take that linear functional and apply it to X, okay? And in fact, we'll see, this is often called iota. This is an isometry, i.e. The norm of iota of X, where here this norm is like two applications of this definition. So you get, first of all, define a norm on X dual, then a norm on X double dual. That's just the norm of X. So this is particularly telling you that even though the first dual might not be so big, the double dual is at least as big as the thing we started with. Okay. We'll come back to stuff about double duals in much more detail than possibly anyone cares for. Don't worry, there's plenty of the double duals will be important. Okay. Yeah, I guess we need a few other bits of generality before we can get onto the big theorem. So, if X and Y are Banach spaces, X cross Y means the vector space X cross Y with norm, that the norm of the pair x comma y is the norm of x in the space x plus the norm of y in the space y. Okay, and you can check pretty easily that that thing is a new Banach space. Here's an unfortunate thing. So if z is closed in x, and x is a Banach space, then Z is itself a Banach space, and that's pretty easy. The fact that you've got closure just means a Cauchy sequence in Z has its limit also in Z, so that if you just restrict the norm to Z, it's still complete. We can define X mod Z, okay? Which, it's just the vector space quotient. So it's equivalence classes of elements in X, where two things are equivalent if they differ by an element of Z. We put a norm on it in the following way. So I'll write X plus Z to one of these equivalence classes. It's a vector up to adding some arbitrary element of the subspace Z. And this is just the infimum over all the little Zs in Z of the norm of X plus Z. Okay? So you should think here, like, there's our subspace Z. You take some point here. X plus Z, of course, looks like some line parallel to Z. And then the norm of this line here will be the point that has the smallest norm, which in this case would be down there. Okay? But, as we've actually already seen in way back in problem set one in the tutorials, this infimum is really an infimum. And in this finite dimensional case, it's realized by a minimum, but we saw in those sort of L1 examples that, in general, there might not actually be a closest point on that plane to zero. Okay, now, exercise. is not as trivial as one might hope, and is so interesting that it has been on the final exam two out of the three times that I've taught analysis three in the past, that does actually define complete normal on the quotient vector space. Can't say I didn't want it. But it's only two out of three times. You can find it proven in the textbook and many other places. Okay, so maybe just a warning. If Z is closed in X, they need not exist. W, another closed subspace. So X is isomorphic to Z direct sum W. That is, you can have subspaces that don't have complements, unlike in the Hilbert space world, where the notes point out an example and give you a reference for seeing a proof. Okay, so let's try and prove a theorem about all Banach spaces. So the theorem that gets everything going is the Baer category theorem. Category here predates the use elsewhere in mathematics of the word category and has nothing to do with category theory. It's just like hurricanes, category one, category two, category three. Maybe let me have a little aside just once to say what these categories are. This is all just about metric spaces here. So let X be a metric space. So a set A in X is nowhere dense if its closure has empty interior. Okay, that's a bit of a confusing thing, but let's just have some examples. The real line sitting in R2 is nowhere dense. It's closed already. Its closure was no problem, but you can see its interior is empty. There's nothing. There's nothing that's inside of R, away from points that aren't in R. And in general, if B is a dense open set, then you can see pretty easily that the complement of B is nowhere dense. But I think you just have to think through these examples a few times to make sure you know what's going on. Okay, so let me then just give the definition. We then say A is first category, meager, if it is a countable unit. I'm never again during the course going to use the words first category and second category or meager. They're just there for historical interest. We're going to use the words nowhere dense, or hopefully as much as possible, we just talk about closures and interiors and dense open sets. I think it's not worth installing that language in your brain, or at least it's never been worth it for me. Okay, so let X be a complete metric space. And the complement of a countable union of nowhere dense sets is dense. So that's the results in the theorem, and the just before we prove it, the equivalent corollary, which I think is in my mind easier to understand, which is just the intersection, a countable intersection. Sets is still dense. Okay, so if you have a bunch of open dense sets, if you intersect them, as long as you only do it countably many times, you don't lose density all the way down. I think a really important exercise to make sure you understand how to use the words nowhere dense and open and countable and so on, is to prove that this corollary is the same statement as this one. It's just a matter of unpacking definitions. You don't have to do any, there's no cleverness. It's just seeing that once you unwrap them in a few layers, they're saying the same thing. And I find this corollary is one that feels much more natural to me. And I certainly prefer thinking about the consequences of the bare category theorem by using that corollary. There's actually another corollary that we'll actually use in the later sentence. But let's prove the theorem first. So let An be a sequence of nowhere dense sets. And now let's let U be an open set the first claim, which is just a matter of unpacking complements in the right way, is that it suffices to show that U intersects in a non-empty way with the union of all the AIs complement. Okay. Should put U rather than union. Okay. So, of course, this complement of a union here, we could have also written as the intersection over I of the of those complements. Okay, so why is this enough? So we're trying to show that the complement of this union is dense. Okay, that means that given any point, we need to find something nearby in the complement of the union. Maybe it's actually easier to see why this sufficient statement. We're trying to show that this is, I'm making life too difficult. All that we're trying to do is show that this is dense, okay? So we're just trying to show that for every point we can find points arbitrarily close. So just think of the point you're trying to get arbitrarily close to, just let U be a really tiny ball around it, and we can find a point in that ball in there. No matter how small the ball was, we can still find a point in the complement. So we can find arbitrarily close points to our given point X in here by taking smaller and smaller system balls. Great, okay, not so difficult. So how does this go? Well, we start at the beginning that A1 is a no-weighted dense set. So we can say that A1 closure has no interior. So the complement intersects U, okay? I mean, if A1 closure complement did not intersect U, that's just saying that U is inside A1 closure, but that's showing us an interior. Okay, so we pick X1, and U take away A1 closure. That was not empty by that. And we pick an epsilon 1, so that, well, notice here that A1 closure being a closed set, its complement is an open set, and so these are both open sets. So not only can we pick a point in there, we can actually pick a whole open ball in there. And so we can say that this ball around X1 of radius epsilon 1 is still entirely contained in U take away that closure. Okay. And so then we define U2 to actually not quite be that ball, but a slightly smaller ball. Okay. Now, once we've done that, we can do things inductively. So given an open set, UI, we just sort of do the same thing again with U replaced by UI. So choose a ball, BI, which is the ball around some XI with radius epsilon I divided by 2. Well, actually, sorry, let's just say that, which is contained in UI minus AI closure, and let UI plus 1 be the ball of half that radius. Okay. So, what's happening? So, certainly these UIs are a nested sequence of balls. Each BI is in the previous ball UI, so the balls are getting smaller and smaller. And what we can say is that if I look at I guess BI, sorry, am I doing this wrong? I wanted to do slightly better than this. I made a mistake back here. So here we just picked this ball so that it was contained in U takeaway A1. We can do even better and insist that the closed ball there is in there, just by making the epsilon ever so slightly smaller. If we could have done this so it was contained in, we could make epsilon smaller into the closed ball. And so let's keep doing. So now now there's no need to take closure here because we just have those BIs. But the point is that BI doesn't intersect, let's say BJ. Doesn't intersect any of the previous AIs up to that point because we picked BI outside the complement of AI. But it was also inside UI, which itself had been outside the complement of AI minus 1, and so on. Okay. And the radii converge to 0. Now, we needed to do this dividing by 2 trick here to make this happen. Otherwise, you could imagine you've got some sequence of balls that are constantly moving around as they need to keep dodging the remaining bits of the AIs, but their radii aren't actually shrinking to 0. and then you couldn't conclude that there was a point that was in all of the BIs, okay? But since we've got this nested sequence of balls whose radii are actually converging to zero, the intersection of all of those BJs is a single point. And then by this condition, it's in none of the AIs, and we're done. Okay, it was in the complement of the union of all the AIs. But yeah, but you do have, there is a sort of scary step in here, which I want to warn you about because the same scary feature happens on assignment four. If you had this nested sequence of balls, but whose radii weren't converging to zero, you couldn't even prove that there was anything in that intersection. You could have a nested sequence of balls whose radii aren't converging to zero, but which has empty intersection. How would you possibly prove that there's a point in the intersection of all of them? They might all be moving around slightly, staying inside of each other, but never there's nothing that stays in all of them. If the radii converge to zero, then you can produce a point just by saying, oh, pick one point from each of the balls, okay? And because the radii converge to zero, if you just pick one point from each of the balls, that's a Cauchy sequence, because any later pairs are inside the ball that the first one was in, and then you use completeness to show that limit that Cauchy sequence had a converging point, which gave you a point in the intersection. But without the radii converging to zero, you couldn't make that conclusion there. Okay. Great.
So Scott, when you say EI greater than zero, is that like, are you choosing a new epsilon every time?
Yes. So here at each point, we're given some open set U. We knew that because this thing was a non-empty open set, we can pick some point in it. In fact, pick some whole open ball in it. In fact, pick some whole closed ball inside of it. And so we just picked xi and epsilon I however we needed to, so that we could fit this closed ball inside that set.
So is there anything something like the epsilon i is like growing by a factor of 2?
Because remember ui itself was also a ball, okay? And this bi is sitting inside that ui,
right.
And you can't fit a ball of bigger radius inside a ball of smaller radius. That really does keep working. But that's a good point. You do need to prove a little lemma that EI plus epsilon I plus 1 is really smaller than epsilon I, and then this extra division by 2 lets you show that it converges to 0. Okay. So, I wrote one corollary here. Let me write another corollary, which is actually the one we'll always use. And again, it can be an exercise to unpack definitions to see that they're actually the same. So, if X, a complete metric space, is a countable increasing union, closed sets, at least one has non-empty interior. Okay? Now this one I think is easy to derive from the other guys. You just say, oh, what if we had this countable increasing union of closed sets, and let's say they all had empty interior. Okay? That would be saying that their complements were all dense. So you could intersect them all, and get something that was still dense. However, we know that the intersection of those complements is actually empty, because we've just said that X here is the union of all of these sets here. Okay? And the empty set sure ain't dense. So that one's pretty easy to derive, but definitely a good exercise to write it down carefully. And then a corollary of that an infinite dimensional Banach space. Can't have countable algebraic basis. So here, algebraic basis just means sort of as opposed to the Hilbert space idea of basis, an algebraic basis is just some collection of vectors that's linearly independent, and you can write any vector as a finite linear combination of the things from the basis. Should I write that down? Are people happy with what algebraic basis means? Importantly, it's finite linear combinations, even from an infinite, if you're on an infinite algebraic basis, you're saying that every element is still a finite linear combination of things from that set, because infinite linear combinations might not make sense without thinking about topologies. Okay, and the proof here is now really easy. Suppose you had some countable basis, you just define X sub n to be the spans of the first n of them, okay? Well, this is obviously a closed subspace, the whole Banach space. And it has empty interior by the assumption that our Banach space was infinite dimensional. You've got this plane here, this n-dimensional plane, but you can always find something outside of it, and then just doing a bit of vector space arithmetic, you can find something very, very close to it, just barely outside of it, and that means that it's got no interior. You can find points off the plane that are near any point, okay? And then this corollary does it. This is obviously a countable increasing union. The fact, assuming that the Xn's are an algebraic basis, so, is an algebraic basis. That's exactly just saying that the union of the Xn's is all of X. That is, any X can be written as some finite linear combination. But that contradicts this corollary here. Okay. How are we going for time? We have 3 minutes to prove the principle of uniform boundedness. It's not a reasonable thing to do. So let me state the principle of uniform boundedness and maybe try and indicate to you why it's such a surprising fact. We sold our soul at that point in the proof there, okay? We made infinitely many choices all the way down. A lovely thing to think about if you have a lot of time on your hands is how to recover as much constructivity as possible in all the theorems that follow, because the way that we're proving them here, you're sort of hopeless, and many of the theorems promise you things, but it's very hard to think how you'd write down an algorithm that produces that promised thing because of that step in the axiom of choice. If you want to do constructive mathematics, the way to do it is to introduce the notion of a bare space, which is just some complete metric space in which the bare category theorem is true. The axiom of choice guarantees that all spaces are bare spaces, so in classical mathematics you don't normally introduce that definition. And if you really want to do things constructively, you should say, well, a sort of constructive bare space is a space equipped with an algorithm that produces, that proves that this intersection is dense. Like, it shows you how to find a point arbitrarily close to anything else that's in some intersection. And then everything that we do later on becomes constructive again. Okay. Okay, so the uniform boundedness principle is very simple. So X and Y Banach spaces. And then we have some arbitrary family. So I'll use the index alpha, so you don't worry whether it's countable or not. It's just any old family of operators, and the bounded operators from X to Y. So let's say, suppose T alpha is pointwise bounded, i.e. For all X in the domain X, the set, the supremum, as we vary alpha over the norm of T alpha X, and of course that's the norm in, do I need to say? Yeah, no, I don't need to. is a single exia, yeah. Norm with respect to y is finite, then in fact, the supremum of the norms of the t-alphas is finite. Okay, the proof turns out to be really easy once you have the bare category theorem and some of its corollaries, so we'll do that next time, maybe all I'll say for now is that it really is a quite ridiculous theorem. I mean, this is not usually the sort of thing that you expect to know how to, expect to be able to do, but amazingly, the axiom of choice lets you do that. Okay, we'll see lots and lots of applications of this and improve of it next time. Sorry, I haven't got assignments to give back to you yet. I'm getting there. I forget, does someone remember what the planned due date is for the essay draft? It must be coming up.
13th, I believe.
That's next Friday?
Yeah.
Okay, great. Let me know if you have questions, complaints, etc. about the essay. And then when is assignment 4 due?
27.
Still a while. Okay.
Next week,
yep.
After the draft, the actual thing's due, and then the next week, the last assignment.
So 13th, 20th, and 27th.
Yep.
Okay. We'll see how that goes.